Good morning. Thank you so much, all of you, for coming. It's a great pleasure to welcome you all today to the IISS to discuss the weaponization of social media and what we can do about it. The change that social media has imposed on our world and our societies in the last decade and a half has been absolutely staggering. And it's not just our social lives that have experienced that profound change. The security of our political institutions, of our personal lives and our privacy, and indeed the very concept of truth itself, now seems to be increasingly called into question by this technology. But we're very fortunate today to have Dr. Kristin Lords join us to speak about how social media is being weaponized and what we can do about it. Dr. Lord's career spans the fields of both technology and innovation and also conflict and conflict resolution. She's currently the president and CEO of the nonprofit IREX, which works to improve global access to education and to information. Previously, she served as president of the United States Institute for Peace, the director of the Center for New American Security, and she's held several leadership posts at the George Washington's Elliott School for International Affairs. Without any further delay, I will hand over to Kristin. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you very much for being here, everybody. I may stand up so I can see everybody better. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here. It's a real honor to be back at IISS. In fact, I started working on these issues in part here in the library. I lived in London 17 years ago, and I was working on a book called Perils and Promise of Global Transparency, Why the Information Revolution May Not Lead to Security, Democracy, or Peace. It was the most right, least read thing I ever wrote. And I suddenly have found myself cycling back, working on these issues again, but in a very different capacity. As you heard, I have spent a lot of my career in academia and in think tanks like Brookings and CNAS, George Washington University. But now I actually run an organization that's all about doing things. And one of the things that we do is help improve citizen resilience to disinformation and misinformation, which has become, again, a very, very hot topic. So I'm going to give you just a brief overview, and then I hope we can have an open discussion. I've read the list, and I see that we have some very knowledgeable people in the room, so I want to make sure we can have a conversation. So I hope that all of you have seen this book by Pete Singer and Emerson Brooking, my colleagues at the New America Foundation. They wrote this book, Like War, the Weaponization of Social Media, and what they argue is that, you know, in the past, it was frankly very expensive to cause mass discord, sow dissension in societies. But now, thanks to the spread of information communications technology, basically you need a smartphone and you can reach the entire world for very, very little cost. And I'll come back to this later. The fascinating thing about this book for me is that Pete and Emerson are defense and security experts, and they end this book, which is very much about global strategy and security, focused on media literacy and the need to give citizens media literacy. So that's where I'm going to come back to you in just a bit. So let me talk a little bit about dimensions of the threat, and I'm going to be very, very quick. We can talk more in depth later if you like. First of all, the weaponization of social media, we're seeing serious intervention in elections. I'm sure some of you may have read a tad in the press about intervention in the US elections by Russia, but it's really a global phenomenon. And just last week I was reading in the New York Times about Russian interference in the elections in Madagascar. I'm not clear why the Russians want to interfere in Madagascaran elections, but it just goes to show you how prevalent this trend has become. Efforts to undermine governments. My own organization started doing this kind of work in Ukraine, where there was, frankly, a very concerted effort to undermine a reform government that was not popular by some of Ukraine's larger neighbors. Sowing polarization and social discord. It's not necessary in this world to have a directed, targeted strategy to accomplish a particular goal. It can simply be to sow divisions that are already there. So if we look, for instance, at the interference in the US election, what we see is a lot of it was not fake news. A lot of it was not disinformation. A lot of it was spreading information that was not actually untrue. It was actually using false identities and bots in order to sow dissent on issues that are already contentious in the American system. Anti-immigration sentiment, Black Lives Matter, gun rights, where people try to, or you know, adversaries try to manipulate, inflame these existing views in order to just cause dissent and discord. And that's frankly, unfortunately, a very easy thing for an adversary to do in this environment. Wide dissemination of hate speech and conspiracy theories. This isn't new. Conspiracy theories and hate speech have been along for a long time. In fact, the book I mentioned that I wrote long ago that I care to recount, it actually starts with a fake news story. In Afghanistan, there was a widely spread story that an American soldier had flushed a Quran down the toilet. It was completely false. It was proven false. But it circulated widely, and 17 people actually died in the protests that ensued. And that was long before Facebook was all over countries like Afghanistan. Discrediting dissidents, political opposition, and social movements, whether it's the movements in Hong Kong right now, whether it's the movements in Sudan, we are seeing a very organized effort to discredit these kinds of movements by regimes. And undermine the credibility of those actors who are leading those movements. Recruitment to terrorist and extremist groups. I don't need to tell an audience at IISS how groups like ISIS, groups like Shabaab, have managed to use social media and the internet in order to attract recruits. But also now we're seeing this tactic used much more broadly, right-wing extremist groups, for instance, including in the West. And then, of course, mis- and disinformation campaigns that threaten public health and other public policy concerns. I just talked to someone in the agriculture industry, where there's a huge amount of disinformation. In public health, we see Ebola and polio vaccinators being killed because of disinformation being spread on social media. And of course, even in countries like the UK, France, the United States, we have an anti-vaccine movement that's leading to measles outbreaks. You know, I never thought in my lifetime I would see measles outbreaks in the United States. And we have social media to thank for it. Just to give you a sense of how prevalent this kind of disinformation can be in the lead up to elections, which is a particular concern of ours, and IREX co-sponsored with Facebook and Thomson Reuters Foundation yesterday at the Trust Conference a discussion about disinformation and misinformation in the lead up to elections. In the most recent Brazilian presidential election, this study by Cristina Tardoguela, pardon my Portuguese, and her colleagues, found that 56% of the most shared political images in the lead up to the election were misleading in some form. So that just gives you a sense. And unfortunately, when we think about the threat landscape, it's growing. Half of the world's population is online now. The other half, you know, they're coming on as well. 3.84 billion people use social media, and that's up 9% since 2018. And that's 9% of a pretty large number, so that's a lot of people. Daily active Twitter users rose 11% in 2018 to 134 million. And Facebook, obviously, is even a much larger audience. That's active users rising to 2.37 billion in 2018. And this isn't just people sharing cat photos and looking at pictures of grandchildren. This is also people getting their news. So in the United States, 71% of Americans read their news on Twitter, and 67% of Facebook's 2.37 billion global users use Facebook as their primary news source. And this is all coming from Pew Research Center, which I consider to be a very reputable source. Sorry, are you taking a photo of that?
Yes.
You are. The threat is escalating. A new Oxford University study found that organized social media manipulation campaigns have taken place in 70 countries. That's up from 48 countries in 2018 and 28 countries in 2017. And if you haven't seen that study, I encourage you to read it. It just came out in the last couple of months. We see wider usage by non-state actors as well. In 2017, ISIS had a confirmed 47,000 overt Twitter accounts. And of course, that wildly understates the number of accounts because, frankly, we're not that good. We're not that good at tracking down how many accounts there are. And then again, just to use the example of the US election campaign, I understand there's a bit of a debate about this in the UK, I'm not going to go there. Twitter reports that Russian generated propaganda was delivered to users 454.7 million times, and Facebook internal analyses estimate that 126 million users saw Russian disinformation on its platform during the 2016 election. And again, not all of that was untrue information. Some of that was just inflammatory or taking an existing story and putting commentary around it with the intent to sow discord. So technology, of course, is accelerating the threat. False images and image manipulation are getting more and more sophisticated. This is image. This is also voice. I was in a meeting with CEOs last week, and you know, many of us were constantly getting called by our CFO saying, I'm sure you didn't really send this to me, but I got an email saying that you need us to me to wire you money while you're traveling. It's not true. A CEO told me recently of a publicly traded company that someone had actually doctored the voice, his voice that he from a speech, public speech he'd given, and reanimated it to request his CFO to do something. So it's images, it's voices, and deep fakes are getting so sophisticated that they can actually be very hard to differentiate what is a real image and what is not. And then bots and sock puppets are basically the masked identities, either automated spread of disinformation or fake identities that have been set up. In some cases, you know, people being paid in large armies in order just to assume a false identity and spread information that is either completely untrue or meant to sow discord. And another happy slide here. The weaponization of social media is becoming a policy tool of choice by authoritarian states. Russia is, just to give one example, a study of 28 Russian government-controlled Instagram accounts registered 145 million projected total interactions. And this is a really effective strategy. It's relatively low cost. It has a big impact. And China, the so-called 50 cent army, which is basically paid people who are spreading information on social media, generates around 448 million online comments every year. And this is just a graphic representation of the Oxford University study I mentioned. And there are many, by the way, there are many other countries using disinformation, misinformation, social media. I encourage you to read the Oxford University study to learn more. So how does this actually work? One way is by creating familiarity with content. You know, our brains are wired so that the more that we see information, after a while we start to think that it's true. Familiarity breeds, you know, a sense of comfort with that information. Confirmation bias, if we're already inclined to believe a certain thing or a certain person or a certain organization, if we see a piece of information that appears to be from that source confirm our bias, you know, we may not be as careful in checking our sources and really thinking critically about it. I'm going to blend together the issue about social networks and identity. You know, if we have identify with a certain social group and we see things being forwarded by in our social group, we tend to read it. And this is particularly concerning because a 2016 study showed that 59% of links that are forwarded on social media have actually not been read or opened by the person who forwarded it or clicked on it. So if you are members of your family or one of these people, I urge you, please exercise caution and actually look at what you are forwarding before you press the forward button. Cognitive science. Basically, we can't just treat this as an analytic problem. This is why fact-checking sites are not purely the answer. We don't only analyze information we get using our analytic minds. There's also an emotional response. And a lot of effective misinformation, disinformation, fake news is actually designed specifically to generate an emotional response. And that's what makes people, it actually lights up a different part of our brain. And so that's what makes people act differently than they would if we sort of step back, took a deep breath, reviewed the sources. And so part of media literacy is not just about giving people the tools to see what's fact or fiction, but also recognizing emotional manipulation so that when they're feeling it, they might take a breath before they press the forward button. And that's one of the reasons why fake news is shared more widely than corrections. you know, you see a news story, it's very inflammatory, people share it around. Maybe a correction comes out the next day or the next week. People don't tend to pay as much attention. It's just not as sensational, it doesn't get that emotional response. And so, you know, we're sort of fighting a losing battle here with our own brains if we let our emotions take control. But we're emotional social beings, so that's not going to completely go away. We just have to somehow learn to deal with this. So how should societies respond? Now that I have completely depressed you and made you think this is an unsolvable problem, I don't think it is completely a solvable problem, by the way. I think it is something to be managed. You know, the way we think about terrorism, no serious security analyst thinks we can eliminate terrorism. Nobody, right? Nobody. But we think we can degrade, we think we can disrupt, we think we can minimize, we think we can isolate. That's basically the way I think we have to think about this threat. And just the way with terrorism, we can't think about using only military tools or only intelligence tools. We also have to think about a wider set of tools in the toolbox. I would argue we need to do the same with misinformation and disinformation. There are three major options that I have seen so far. Perhaps others in the room would like to add some bullets, and I would love to see that. One is government regulation. You've seen a lot of talk around the world about actually regulating social media platforms, elections. You know, this is definitely part of the toolkit, but the problem here is that, one, regulatory responses tend to lag behind. It's so slow to change the policy that, you know, the adversaries or the unwitting or unwitting adversaries who are playing a part in this, you know, you're always a step behind. And the other issue is that this is kind of the whole issue is kind of a jujitsu move. The fact that we live in open societies is what makes this possible, and the more restrictive and censoring we become, the more we lose a lot of the assets of living in free and open societies. And so this is very, very tricky. And so I think it's one reason why we can't just only talk about government regulation. You know, I'm not saying there's not a role here, but I don't think this is going to solve 100% of the problem. There's no chance, unless we want to live in police states. Tech platform response and technology responses. You know, I want to separate the platform and the technology responses. Technology responses are using artificial intelligence, algorithms, in order to sort of capture, detect fake news, the viral spread of information. Those are useful tools. And tech platforms, there are things that the tech platforms can do, of course. And you know, they don't want to be in the middle of this at all, but they have gradually been sucked in. They really don't have a choice. But they don't want to be arbiters of truth. They don't want to be arbiters of big social debates. They have shareholders. They make their money by people clicking on things and sharing information. So they're in a little bit of a tricky spot. You know, it's really hard to feel sorry for billionaires who are part of this, but they are admittedly in a very awkward position, but there's much more that they can do. There's much more they can do on the education side. There's much more they can do on restricting the spread of information. They didn't want to do it on spreading information by terrorist groups. They said they couldn't do it and blah, blah, blah. Guess what? They're doing it now, right? They've decided it's worth it and they can do it. So there's a lot more they can do, and I think they're starting to come to grips with this based on my personal interactions. Not at the level they need to, but I think they're starting to realize that unless they get a grip on this themselves, they're going to be regulated in a way they don't like. So we'll see. But this is actually, the last point is the point I know a little bit more about, and that's citizen resilience information manipulation. My view, and my colleagues at IREX, and people like Pearson and Emerson Bergen, we believe that when the cost of producing disinformation, misinformation is effectively zero, when it can be done by almost anyone from anywhere, when there are still free societies, when tech and regulatory platforms will invariably lag behind because creative people will always find a way around. We believe the only way to help reduce the threat is to also work on the information consumer side. You know, if people stop sharing that stuff, if it becomes socially unacceptable to share fake news, if people become more savvy about what they are seeing, if people demand quality information, then, you know, again, it's not going to be 100% solution to the problem, but we view it as an important part of the solution, part of the solution. And these are just a couple of colleagues of mine in Washington, D.C. that have talked about the fact that we really can't only work on the regulatory and the tech platform side. We just really, really have to work at the level of the individual citizen. Now, this has challenges, which I'll come back to, but it's doable, and I'll come back to that, too. So this is a photo of Ukraine. My organization, IREX, which is a 50-year-old global education and development organization, we are actually working directly with the Ministry of Education in Ukraine. We have support from their Foreign and Commonwealth Office, by the way. Thank you very much, taxpayers. And the Ministry of Education really thought that this issue of critical information consumption is such an important skill for citizens, such an important part of their democracy and their security, that they now have introduced into the curriculum critical thinking and media literacy across the curriculum. My organization, IREX, has helped them to do that. We are now, we started with a pilot, then we went to 400 schools. By the end of December, we'll be in 650 schools. And the intent is that we will also soon be in pre-collegiate teacher training, post-service teacher training, so that it stays in the curriculum, and also that it will become part of the national curricula tools, so that teachers can continue to teach this way for a long time to come. That's easier in a centralized education system like Ukraine than it is in a country like the US, where we have 50 different state education curricula, but you know, it's definitely something that Ukraine is taking very seriously, and we see some really good responses, and I'll come back to some of the data on that. Ukraine is not the only country trying to do this seriously at a national level. Sweden, Estonia, and especially Finland have made this a very serious national issue. And I know the UK also has a national online threat strategy. I think, so maybe the UK is getting there as well. I think Finland may be the most advanced. They monitor disinformation. They also have a national school curricula, adult outreach to help people consume information critically. Admittedly, it's a smaller country and more homogenous in some ways, but also the signs are that it's been quite effective and it's considered a model. What we've learned at IREX, by the way, we're now doing this work in 13 countries, including the United States. What we've learned is that, and we actually, our data are getting better and better over time. These are some of the older data. And so when we were, when we evaluated the results of the students who had been exposed to even a small number of media literacy lessons, we found that they were twice as likely to detect hate speech, 18% better at identifying fake news stories, and then adult learners, this is actually a year and a half after the training based on an independent evaluation, so none of this data is self-reported. They were 8% more likely to demonstrate sophisticated knowledge of the news media industry, which in Ukraine on media ownership is actually a huge issue in critical information consumption, and 13% better identifying a fake news story. In Jordan, where it's obviously a different environment, we found that relative to a control group, young people who went through the program were 44% better to identify and analyze fake or false or manipulative information, showed a 14% greater sense of control over how they respond to information, and 78% more knowledgeable about the news media industry. And again, that's important because if ownership is really playing into what you are seeing and political interests in media are playing in, that's just information you need to have. And none of this curricula is about telling people what to think. It's just giving them some tools to evaluate what are the factors that might be influencing why I am seeing this information in my social media feed, what are the factors that might be influencing this perspective on the story, what are alternate opinions that might be out there, and how do I actually check if I want to whether this is credible or not, including images. There are challenges. First of all, reaching different demographic groups. Working in the school system is great because you have long-term impact and potentially can reach nationally. But the problem is that frankly, in a lot of countries, young people don't even vote. So you're talking about a long-term solution. And among American Facebook users 65 and over, they are 7 times more likely to share news from fake sources than their younger counterparts. And that finding has been replicated to different degrees in other countries as well. Maybe you have seen this in your own families on Facebook, you know, grandma forwards things that you really wish you wouldn't. But you have to reach different demographic groups in different ways. Maybe through libraries, we've used that as a venue. We're experimenting with online courses, and we've actually had a 25% completion rate, which is a lot higher than the 5% completion rate that Coursera and other big MOOCs have. Reaching scale is a problem. And there are all kinds of open research questions about how many people need to be better at consuming information critically in a society to really move the needle and make a difference. Unanswered question. Staying current but apolitical. We think it is so important for us not to take stands on what is true or what is false, what is real and what is fake. We want to give people the tools to consume and make up their own minds. And that means in the curriculum materials, you have to be so careful that you're not just showing one perspective or one news source as being perpetually the purveyor of fake news. You really have to be so careful, or else you can turn off the very people you're trying to arm. And staying agile. This is such an evolving threat. The tools are evolving, the technologies are evolving, the issues are evolving, the polarization in societies is evolving. But there is a potential. Again, I think that media literacy at scale is part of the solution, but it also should be part of a holistic strategy that involves government regulation, technology solutions, and platform solutions. Really need a high-level commitment. It's really hard to see how you can swing the balance in the society unless there is a national response, and also by a lot of different actors. And it has to be sustained. We don't see this going away anytime soon. In fact, we see the threat escalating. And there has to be global and national coordination at scale. And that includes international cooperation. I wish NATO would take this more seriously. You know, NATO takes cybersecurity very seriously, and there's a lot of high-level cyber cooperation. It looks at the technology side, the intelligence side. It doesn't really look at citizen resilience very much. Long-term solutions, like being in schools, are key. But you know, let's think about the short term. There are a lot of elections coming up around the world just in the next 6 to 12 months. There tends to be a spike in fake news and disinformation right in the period before an election. We really need to think about targeted solutions. And last, the research and data on this is extremely poor. It is extremely poor. You saw me show you some data. I'm very sorry to tell you that IREX has some of the most robust findings in the media literacy world right now. That's pathetic. We shouldn't. There should be a lot better data. We're trying to iterate and improve all the time. But it's such a small group of actors performing in a small way relative to the size of the threat that the data is just really poor and the resources and the attention are just wholly inadequate. So with that, and I could talk more about that, but I think it's time for me to turn it over to your questions and comments. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kristen. That was That was absolutely terrific. I'm going to abuse my position and ask the first question, if I may, and then we'll open the floor. I think one thing that your talk has highlighted brilliantly is the myriad reasons why these top-down solutions from both governments and from tech companies are extremely hard. And you mentioned some about technical capacity, but one thing that really comes home in this is that maybe a good disinformation campaign is sort of 95% truth, 5% falsehood, if that, or even something that's misleading rather than false, because you could argue that misleading is a matter of interpretation. Is it even possible for governments and tech companies to create regulations on what's misleading as opposed to false?
I think the answer is no. I mean, if I put an inflammatory headline on a story that's otherwise truthful, you know, unless you're going to start to have the most picayune censorship that would be highly political, I don't see how you can do that in a democratic society. I really don't. And that's why I think that citizen critical information consumption has to be part of it. That doesn't solve the problem either. And then people will disagree. People are always going to disagree. But again, it's not about eliminating or having some, you know, ministry of truth that determines what's true or not. It's about how to contain the threat so that we can actually function as free societies. I mean, that sounds a little bit hyperbolic, but you know, if you think about it, I don't think it is. And also, I think one response we also don't want to see is a response for citizens to not start to not trust anything. You know, you don't really want citizens to say, I'm getting noise from everywhere, I don't know what to believe, I'm just going to disengage and hold up and just focus on my own family and my own life. And, you know, we see, you know, a lot of people at IISS study conflict situations, extreme conflict, and that's what people do. They sort of hunker down and persist. I don't think that's how we have thriving societies. And so somehow we need to give enough people the tools to continue to be able to have civic dialogue and debate. And the question is, how do you do it? I don't think we can do it unless we start talking about the human brain and human behavior.
Fantastic, thank you. Okay, I don't doubt we've got lots of questions. Please raise your hand if you have a question. Okay.
If you could kindly introduce yourself, I'd
absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
Sir, right there, you think you were first.
I'm Josh Owen Forster, I'm a political consultant, and I've worked in Westminster for far too long. And it's this issue of high-level commitment that I wonder about, because I don't know that much about Donald Trump's views on your work, but I rather suspect he's not taking it too seriously and is perhaps somewhat questioning. I would also suggest in this country, and I would suggest this applies both to the Labour Party and the Conservative Party, Alistair Campbell was notorious for sort of having an ambivalent view about this, and I would suggest that Dominic Cummings and others of that ilk are not necessarily the most supportive of the sorts of things you want to do. So how do you get over that obstacle?
Yeah, and it's a very fair observation. You know, President Trump's administration does support this work. U.S. government does support this kind of work. However, President Trump himself is actually a master of using social media to his advantage. I would be very surprised if a politician at his level would want to lose a political advantage. And so I don't expect him to. I have never heard him talk about the subject of media literacy. I don't expect to. And so I think the question is, you know, if politicians are going to continue to use tools like this to advance their own objectives, which they will, and we live in free societies with free speech, you know, how do we actually keep citizens so that they can evaluate what our presidents and prime ministers and others, their critics, their supporters, have to say? And that's where I think the key comes in, to stay so ruthlessly apolitical. Because if the media literacy work becomes seen as a political act, all bets are off. But I think if we can have it in the schools, have it be sort of a public service, you know, hopefully it will just stay under the radar enough that no one can attack it. But no, I am not expecting a big endorsement from President Trump anytime soon. He's a much savvier user of social media than that. Yes, sir. Oh, you're supposed to be calling on people.
I can happily leave it to you.
I used to be a professor, so I call on people instinctively.
I'm very happy to leave
it. No, please, okay. That would be my guest.
All right, we're going to start from the back and work our way forward. You, sir, right at the back.
Hi, my name's Alex Folks. I work as an election observer around the world looking at social media. I wonder if you've seen a paper by Kate Jones at Oxford University that came out this last week through Chatham House, which was about the human rights dimension. And in particular, how social media algorithms restrict what you see, so that even if you are an American voter, for instance, who sees a story about President Obama being born in Kenya, which is clearly factually untrue, the fact that you see reinforcement, you don't see a response from Obama or Democrats, you don't even see a fact check, because that's the way the algorithms work, and there's a human rights free speech dimension there. But also, that the platforms themselves are basing their work, even now when they are starting to make progress, very much around an American-centric or even a Californian-centric view of what should be right, and trying to impose that across the world, refusing to pay any attention to local, I work in elections, so in my field, local election laws, to the extent that actually they're doing more harm than good each time they make an advance. I wonder if you had any comments on that.
Yeah, first of all, I didn't see the paper. I looked at it quickly, I'll admit, but I thought it was very interesting. And I do think this is a human rights issue. And one thing I've been hearing more and more concern about is, I've actually been talking about responses at the level of a society. I think the level of a response when you talk to individual dissidents is very different. If you are an individual dissident in Hong Kong or Sudan or whatever, yesterday I heard a very moving presentation by a Philippine journalist. You know, if you are one of these people who is being constantly trolled and targeted and threatened, you know, what is your response as an individual or as a community of journalists and dissidents? You know, how do you actually respond? Media literacy is not your tool of choice. And nor is necessarily regulation of things that the tech platforms can do a little, but some cases not a lot. I think that is a very important question. I mean, there's so many research and applied research questions that are unanswered at this point. I actually think that that's a really rich area for exploration. And as for, you know, decisions being made in California, which as you hinted is not considered the rest of the United States by most Americans, I think that, again, they have been very reluctant to get in the space. And in some cases, I think it is fair to say, have been fairly ham-handed. And if you look at Facebook in Myanmar, if I have colleagues from Facebook in the room and I said, are you all really proud of how you handled the situation in Myanmar? I think they would be sore-pressed to say, yes, that was our best moment at Facebook. And I think that they're just really grappling with how to deal with this. But like I said, originally I think the response was, that's not our problem. You know, we're like the phone company. If someone has a nasty phone call with their mom or their boyfriend or girlfriend over the phone, you know, you don't blame the phone company. I think they're starting to recognize that they can't back up anymore. They're now past that. So we're past the denial phase. We are at the, we really ought to do something phase. They have not figured out what to do. And even in the last 2 weeks, I've talked to people from Twitter and Facebook who have said, we've started to do things, but frankly, it's very kind of, they did not use the word scattershot. That would be my editorializing. But they basically said, we have nuggets of things that we were doing, but we don't really have a concerted response. But they don't know what to do. And part of the reason is that the data and the research is really, really weak. You know, we have some fairly robust data. We should have some more in December that's even more robust than what I've shown you. But, you know, it's not nearly up to scale the problem, and as you hinted, contexts change, audiences change, countries change, and so the responses have to change, and the evidence base is just not there. So what I would really like to see is, we've started a partnership with the New America Foundation because of this, and we hope others will join us and support us, where we would like to have much more of a clearinghouse to share evidence and best practices and also do independent research. Which of these tools work better? Which of these interventions work better, one versus another? If someone comes and tells us at IREX that another tool works better, we'll throw ours out tomorrow and use theirs, but there's not an evidence base.
Cool. I think we're going to start taking two groups of questions because we've got a lot of them. Gentlemen there and gentlemen there.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I'm Stefan. I'm currently a master's student. I completed my degree. I was just wondering if you can comment about the news media moguls and how they influence through their social media influence. And I was wondering if you can join that answer to the restrictions that are technological restrictions in Twitter handles or something like that. Like you can only tweet 250 words, and how they use this kind of restriction to their advantage to sort out, like, sort of giving charged political or one-dimensional view or something. If you can just comment on that.
Yeah, sure.
And
thank you
as well, please.
I'm Andras. I'm a conflict advisor in the Foreign Office. Could you please talk a little bit about your work in Ukraine and Jordan and how the curriculum is different depending on the context? And what would that look like in an area or in a country with, let's say, lower levels of human development, or Papua New Guinea or CAR?
Okay, so the first question, I'm really not going to claim to speak for any media moguls. None of them call me, but obviously social media is a very powerful tool for them, and that's true whether it's the New York Times, which likes to hold itself out as a beacon of objective journalism, or you know, some of my colleagues who work in countries where there are oligarchs controlling media and they have very pronounced political views that they're advancing. You know, web, social media is both a huge advantage for them, but it's also an opportunity for them, their reporting to be called into question. In terms of the technology platforms, you know, obviously the parameters, whether it's the length of a Twitter post or how many times you can forward things, it has a huge impact on the spread of this information. So WhatsApp, which is owned by Facebook now, they have now put a limit on how many people you can share to. Facebook has now followed suit, nor has Twitter. Twitter has now put restrictions on political ads. The others have not. I mean, I think we're going to see a lot of competition and pressure in this group about what kinds of policies the firms are going to put in place in order to try and control this beast. But for all the reasons I mentioned before, I think that that moves the needle a little bit. It doesn't solve the problem. And as for the question about different contexts, we are now doing this work in 13 countries. We have not, I'm thinking hard, we have not yet done the work in a country like Central African Republic. So I can't tell you any data on how it would be different. We always tailor the curriculum to the local circumstances and also even to the audience. When you're dealing with Ukraine in the school system, for instance, it's very much designed around, it's actually integrated into the curriculum. So the history curriculum, the social studies curriculum and so on, actually is integrated in not a separate course. And then when we're trying to reach older audiences, we actually did courses through libraries because Soviets actually loved libraries. So Ukraine is rich with libraries. Every village has a library. Doing programming through libraries that attracts older Ukrainians who tend to be out of the cities, that's a different kind of vehicle. In Jordan, we actually have worked through both youth groups and some online content and other also mothers groups, because mothers don't want to see their children consuming information without good skills, and you know, they're worried about what their children might see. And so, you know, we pretty much go in and look at the circumstance and then adapt accordingly. But there's a lot of experimentation that's going on here, and I think one of the nice things about Ukraine for us is we have done this work in many places, but that is where it is most advanced. That gives us the chance to iterate more and get out of a pilot phase, and so the more we can do that, the better evidence base we're going to have.
Great, thank you. Okay, yeah, lots of questions. Gentleman there, lady there, and then we'll come back. Yes.
I'm Mark Briggs from the South Korean Embassy. I was just wondering, on the media literacy aspect, which of them do you think that you need to the fact that it's social media versus when new media comes around, it was ever thus? Like, yeah. If you look at Victorian newspapers, like,
right.
They're awful. You know, you get the first flush of cable news, you know, and people just work it out, which one they are.
Yeah, my book actually looks at the Fashoda crisis in 1898 and how free press in France and England just completely fanned the flames of conflict in the parliaments and so on. Yeah, that's on you. I'll answer your question in a second. I'm sorry, I think we're supposed to read.
Better?
Hi, my name is Leonie. I'm studying security, leadership, and society. Thank you so much for your insights. I just wanted to ask if you make a distinction between organic and paid posts on social media, because would it actually make a difference if there were restrictions, you know, in paid advertising, as it, you know, money does talk and they are able to reach a wider audience through that, and if they were just restricted to organic, maybe then it wouldn't have such a big impact.
Right. Do you want me to take
that? Go for it, yeah.
So yes, as I was starting to answer, no, it's not a new phenomenon, and a lot of the critical thinking skills, a lot of the recognizing and emotional manipulation, doesn't matter if someone hands me a pamphlet on the street, or I read a good old-fashioned newspaper, or I see it on social media, a lot of the things are the same. There are a few things that are different about social media. One is the speed of the spread. One is the fact that it comes from my own social networks. These are people I know that I trust, and that is part of what gives social media its power, because people's guard is down. The other thing is because we can now share video, images. I mean, there are so many ways to captivate attention that go so above and beyond what is possible on, you know, a printed piece of paper. I think that only makes it more powerful. And TV channels, you know, there are so many channels, but do we all get to them? Do we all watch it all the time? But this sort of is fed directly to you when you're, you know, in a coffee shop. So I do think that's where the distinction starts to come in. And as for the issue about organic versus paid content, you know, frankly, I don't think we're going to see a ruling out of paid content because these are businesses, these social media institutions, and they're wildly popular and they're wildly useful. I mean, most of us are on social media all the time. We recruit for jobs, we study for school, we, you know, talk to our families. I mean, there are a lot of things we really value about them, and they're thriving businesses for a reason. People want to be able to do it. You know, I've been in rural Nepal and watched, you know, an 80-year-old woman on FaceTime with her kid halfway around the world, and she can do that because of these tools. So I don't expect that the tools are going to go away, and I don't think that the paid content is going to go away because they're businesses and they have to pay sometime, and consumers like them, and we don't want to pay for it. It's all free to us. However, I think if you give people the tools to recognize, is this a piece of paid, there is a thing called paid content. This is paid content. This is not paid content. I know the difference. I should therefore use a different lens when I look at my social media feed than I do when I'm just reading, you know, my mom's Facebook page. So I think that is where we could move the needle a little bit.
Okay. Yes, gentleman there. Yes.
Thank you very much indeed, Ewan Grant. I'm the former UK Customs Service intelligence analyst covering the ex-Soviet Union. I worked subsequently in Ukraine, including shortly before and immediately after the Maidan, where I saw among much, not all, of the European Commission apparatus, total ignorance of what was going on. They just couldn't get it because they don't understand geopolitics and are somewhat averse to the concept of hybrid warfare, to put, say the least. My question is about your comment. You mentioned how so much work is being done in Ukraine, how it's being done. You also mentioned particularly Finland and Estonia and Sweden. All of those countries, of course, have certain memories of the Soviet Union and Russia. Do you see what is being done? What's the reaction to your work in Western Europe and in academia and civil society in North America? Because large parts of our societies don't, and frankly I feel are much more vulnerable, yeah, much more vulnerable to fake news on that.
Great, thank you. And so you at the back as well.
Hi, James Borelli. I work for a security company called Constellis, and we actually support IRX in Iraq and other places. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, our team in Iraq has been been difficult. Thank you.
And obviously we are kind of on the front line in trying to understand what is real and fake news, and obviously how that affects security for us and our clients. Can I just ask a question again about sort of conventional media, the likes of BBC, CNN? I've heard it said that a lot of people are using social media now because there's a lack of trust in these kind of monolithic news organizations which don't declare their interests, and people are very skeptical as to what their intentions are. What can they do to regain trust and therefore reduce the requirement for people to look to other mediums to get information? And if I could share a short anecdote, I don't follow US politics very closely, but in 2017 I used to live in a flat with someone who was very active and would always have CNN on. And I'd always regarded CNN as a very trustworthy organization for political news. But every morning I would wake up to find coverage of Donald Trump. Regardless of whether there was a famine somewhere or, you know, ISIS, any other issue, every single day there was coverage of Donald Trump, and that actually undermined my view about organization and actually fed into the narrative which had been put against it, but it was biased and had its own agenda.
So on this issue of Western societies, I do think it is easier to get a whole of government, whole of society response when there is a perception that there is a single external threat. That's true no matter what. That's whether it's a hard power threat, whether it's a soft power threat, it's just always easier to unite any group of people, large or small, if they have a shared sense of a common threat. So I think that's true. I think it is a mistake to think that we should need that. And as I tried to say at the beginning, this is not just about Russia. This is not just about China. This is about disinformation in our own societies from lots of different groups with lots of different interests. It's not just about security and democracy, it's also about things like public health and science. And so the threat is so multidimensional. You know, I think it's about arming citizens, and especially our children, to be able to live in this kind of a society over the long term. Now, I will confess, as an analyst, it is not a strength of free societies to get super organized and act on the basis of diffuse threats. But, you know, I think one of the reasons why we're starting to see more mobilized action is because people are starting to recognize, even though it may not have one source, it is a real threat. And it is not just a matter of geopolitics or what have you. It's about human well-being. So hopefully that will help. But, you know, the more people talk about it, the more I think we'll have awareness raising. So that's part of it too. And then as to your question about trust, I think this is a huge issue. I just wrote a couple of pieces for Stanford Social Innovation Review and others about the decline in public trust in institutions generally. You should know that in the latest Edelman Public Trust Barometer, the least trusted group is media institutions. That is a huge problem in a democratic society. I mean, it also feeds the reliance on social media, the reliance on your own personal network, but that's what helps to create these echo chambers and sharing of information and trusting information that maybe people shouldn't and don't evaluate critically enough. So I do think it comes down to rebuilding trust. What will it take? I mean, I think for the media institutions, I think it comes down to one, really being scrupulously objective, or trying to. Trying to stay out of the polarizing identity politics, even though it's hard, and some politicians are really adept at manipulating that to their own advantage. Won't name any names. And then I think that, you know, it's a much bigger issue in society, and if you, we need effective and ethical leaders. One of the reasons people don't trust their leaders right now is, you know, our leaders are not giving us a really great reason to trust them, whether they're corporate leaders or government leaders. I mean, there are huge amounts of corruption. I mean, universities, we just had a huge scandal in the United States about our trust in universities. You know, all of the trusted institutions in society, whether it's police forces or, you know, corporate world, or, you know, we keep getting fed all of information that tells us not to trust people. So I think there has to be some kind of a regeneration of public trust in institutions. It has many sources, but one of them is effective and ethical leaders who appear to actually be serving the public interest rather than their own. That goes for media institutions and everybody else. But it's really hard in that climate. And there's a great new book by Tom Carruthers on a case study of political polarization around the world. It is hard for societies to depolarize once they have begun to polarize. But there are success stories, and there are some sort of hints of paths back. And so I won't get into all of that now, but I think there's some hope there.
Great. I have neglected my IISS colleagues, so I'm going to give it to Ben and Dia.
I'm Ben Barry. I work for IISS. I strongly suspect I'm the oldest person in the room.
So you're the only person who might remember when I was working away on my book in your library?
I haven't been here that long, but...
thanks for that.
I just remind myself of some really positive effects of social media. For example, the BBC journalist France, forcing the BBC to much better... Sorry, the British Airways to much better treat wheelchair users.
But
with regard to the regulation of the social media giants, would a quick win be to simply say to them, whatever country you're operating in, you're subject to law as a newspaper and as a broadcaster? Our legislators often have a tendency to overcomplicate things. And, for example, in the UK, my personal view is that would be a start of the den to promote more responsible behaviour.
All right, I want to answer. I wanted to take two questions.
Yes, please.
Sorry, hi. My name is Dia, working for the Security and Development Programme at the Institute. My question picks up slightly off of what Ben just said, and actually refers to a Washington Post article that I think came out last week or the week before about Twitter, about a number of Saudi Twitter employees who had been part of the company but had previous interaction with their own state's intelligence security services. So on the point of civilian resilience, to what extent does civilian resilience as far as the tech and platform community is concerned, to what extent do the tech and platform communities have a responsibility to work towards civilian resilience by having tighter controls on their own internal structures and employee decisions? Because increasingly, if states are using social media for their own influence operations, then that has to be regulated to a larger degree.
Yeah, I think that, you know, obviously it's incumbent on social media companies to monitor their employees, but honestly, I think there's only so much they can do. I mean, what we're talking about in the Saudi case is this is just a case of traditional espionage. You know, people on the inside were paid informers for the Saudi government. I mean, I think it would be so naive to think that we're going to eliminate espionage in the world in any of its form. And so, yeah, like most espionage, there are things you can do to be better at trying to catch things in your ranks. I think it's incumbent on the social media platforms to do it, in part for they will do that for their own reputations. And also, by the way, if people can pay you to give away, the addresses of dissidents and so on, they can also give away corporate secrets. And these are very, very protective companies. They need to be mindful about it, but I think we have to be realistic about what can be accomplished. You know, just like we can't eliminate inflammatory speech, we're not going to eliminate espionage. It's just how do you eliminate it. And then on the issue of, I just lost your question, was on...
Social media giants should be treated as...
Oh, treated like news media. I mean, I think there are some interesting things there. I know British law is very different from, say, American law. I think it might help in some cases in the UK to do that. In the US, it's not so clear to me. And then I think you really have a country-by-country analysis about what pieces. But also, you know, there's a doability issue, too. When you're talking about, I mean, you saw the number of users we're talking about. You know, at what point is it realistic to think that you can have the same standards as the BBC for every post that is generated on every by every user in every country of the world? I mean, as you started with, I mean, the internet has been a huge social good. I mean, it's remarkable how much it does for people. And so I don't think we are willing to give that up. I think the question is, where are there places where in little nibbles we can, you know, start to reduce the size of the threat? But I wish I could say that, oh, all we have to do is adopt the media regulations in a country to the social media platforms. I'm not positive that will do the trick. And like I said, I think there's some variability by country.
Great. Okay, I think we've got time for two more questions, so I'm going to take the gentleman at the front and just behind you.
Thank you very much. It's Masato Kimura, a Japanese journalist. I am a freelancer and I write an article for Japanese readers. In the last 6 years, I have 140 million page views. But I'm afraid these days their interest is very limited to South Korea. For Japanese, these days foreign country is just only South Korea. And maybe 4 years ago, 5 years ago, they like UK news and European news, but their interest is very limited. And why? It depends on algorithm, or I'm afraid they like what they like. And in Facebook, and so it means many people becoming very narrow visions.
Yeah, a couple of things on this. I mean, I think, yes, the algorithms are set up to feed you more of what you are already consuming. And you happen to be an anti-vax, white supremacist, you are going to get a lot of anti-vax, white supremacist content if that's what you are clicking on. And I think there's something that the tech companies can do on that. And I know Facebook has done some things to try and expose people to a broader range of views. So that's a technology solution. You also pointed out that people like what they like. I think people are going to continue to like what they like. And so the only way to get around that is try to interest people in other things. That can feel like an uphill battle, but you know, I don't think that is going to go away. And then you had one more point I was going to make. I do want to say that it is not actually empirically true that people are as in these information bubbles as we think. There is actually information that people read a wider range of news sources, at least in the US and the UK, according to the research, than the common parlance would suggest. And so that gives me a little hope that maybe people are a little more discerning than we think they are. But I think one unanswered research question, really fascinating research question about media literacy that is unanswered, is do programs like this actually increase the demand for quality journalism? We have some anecdotal response. You know, I was just in Serbia where our team was telling me that they see anecdotally in the groups they're working with that people start actually to consume a wider range of media, look for quality media. But there's not a hard evidence base for that. And I think that is a very important question for journalists like yourself. Can media literacy actually create the demand for quality content? And actually, news subscriptions to the Wall Street Journal, New York Times, and Washington Post have actually gone way up in recent years, suggesting that people are showing a demand for quality news. The mid-sized outlets are really in trouble still, but they actually have seen a spike. So maybe that's a sign of hope too.
Cool. Okay, we have one last very quick question, please.
Brody Sewell, I work for a strategy outfit. There's a lot of talk, or increasing amount of talk, around the balkanization of the internet. And do you think there's a risk, kind of, if and when governments start to regulate, how social media can present this information, that could feed further balkanization of information and the internet? And so, you know, is it really, should it be at government level that this conversation is going on, or should it be above that and looking at kind of international law?
Yeah, I mean, the short answer to your question is yes. And the world I talked about is actually presuming a world where there still is a lot of open access to information. And the strategy that the Russian strategy is to sow discord in open conversations. The Chinese strategy is actually simply denial of access, or make it really hard, where a lot of people don't bother to get around the firewalls, and why would they? There's a lot of content and entertaining content. So, you know, a lot of people in China just are simply unaware of a lot of what's happening in Hong Kong because they're not exposed to it, and they are overwhelmed with information, so they have the feeling that they have a lot of information, but they may not actually have what we would consider to be the full picture. I think more countries are moving in that direction. The Freedom House Internet in the World survey that just came out a few weeks ago shows clearly we continue to see declines in internet freedom. So I think, again, when you're thinking about the global nature of this problem and how it will shape geopolitics for years and years to come, that is another trend to watch, because if it becomes more of a walled garden denial strategy for information, the kind of tools I'm talking about tech platform regulation, government regulation, media literacy, you can throw that right out the window. That only, to the extent they work at all, they work in a certain kind of, on a certain kind of threat surface. They don't actually work if people just literally don't have access. Or, you know, it's not in China that no one has access, it's that very few of the whole, not enough of the whole, have enough access to make a difference.
Great. Thank you.
So on that cheery note, thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for your participation today. Just to let you know about a couple of upcoming events, next Friday we have an event on public confidence in the military, chaired by our very own Ben Berry and featuring Professor Peter Fever. And on Monday, the 9th of December, we have an event on the South Sudanese peace process. You'd all be very welcome at both of those. But for now, please join me in thanking Dr. Wood.